Hey, Sushan. What is going on? Just woke up. Thought I'd go on the YouTubes. Saturdays tend to be a slow day on YouTube, but I had to really search, do a deep dive into what DMs are doing lately, this week. Found one, this guy here, Bandits Keep. I think that's what he calls himself. Remember a year ago I was watching some of his stuff. I forgot all about him, but he's still around. I don't know, remember anything about him personally. I'm sure our alignments are way different from each other's. But he's going to talk about emergent storytelling in D&D campaigns, not just one shots, but campaigns. I would think that a campaign would have a story in it, and you force your players to go through it together as a group. But apparently there's emergent storytelling to be had in a campaign. I prefer one shots with no story, and then the stories end up after the game. After you play your game, you end up with an amazing story. And the story's random. You don't know what it's gonna be until the end. So that's kind of emerge. I hate that word emergent. It sounds gay. But anyway, let's see what he says.
Hey there, welcome to Bandits Keep. I'm Daniel, and in this video we're going to talk about emergent storytelling. You've probably heard that term bounced around a bunch. There's several different ways people define it or get really into nitty-gritty of it. I'm going to talk about my thoughts on it, how you might use it in your campaigns, and I'd love to hear in the comments below how you may have used it before. Okay, so what is it? Effectively, emergent storytelling means that there's no predefined plot. The story, as it would be, happens as you go, and it's almost like if you looked back, right, at the end of your campaign 6 months later, you see the story, right? You see the through path, you see all this, but you didn't see that when you first started. This is emergent storytelling. So you often see the words open world or sandbox tied in when people are talking about this kind of stuff, and that does help because in an open world or sandbox situation where the player characters have a lot of options, right? They have lots of choices just out of the box by this nature.
I like that he's talking about sandboxes because sandboxes don't have stories. But the story part of it, if you're not role playing, your story is going to sound like more of a outline of a plot. Not even a storyboard, just a bare bones outline of what happened. Like someone's journal. It would be like reading someone's journal. And just not complete sentences in the journal. Just this happened, then this happened, something else happens. Something. We killed the bad guy, the end. That's what the story sounds like when you play it back. If there's no role play, if there is role play during the game session, guess what? I've mentioned this 100 times. The story sounds like a radio drama, a radio, remember the Star Wars radio series or the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy series? They were played on the radio. Remember those? That's what you want your story to sound like when you listen to it later on. Anyway.
Through the play, you're going to get this more often. You can still have it in a more linear type adventure, right? You could have an adventure where it takes place with a very specific idea, as long as everybody has the same buy-in, and you can still have lots of interesting stories coming from it.
Well, you got to have a social contract. Number one. Number two, you got to vet your players before you let them in your game. Now, his players are all Scooby-Doo jokesters telling jokes at it. They do some role play, 30% role play, 70% trying to say something funny. That irks me to death. So you vet your players, you want them to role play, you want them to be in character, that kind of thing. At least I do. I do. I'm one of the very few people that do.
For instance, you start in a campaign where there's an evil monarch, and all the players decide,
Oh, so there, anyway, the reason why I even brought up this video is because he says D&D. D&D is hard as hell to roleplay in. Hard as hell. So what is D&D? D&D is a war game. Your army consists of one unit. That's D&D. Now, how are you gonna roleplay that?
We want to play a group of rebels that are going to try to take this monarch down. So, sure, there's some kind of a plot. Again, the player has decided that, and they're going to go in a certain direction, right? Everything they do is going to try to lead towards the idea of taking this monarch down. But everything they do is whatever they do, and they may or may not succeed. Now, what it's not is a bunch of people hanging around waiting in stasis until the player characters get there to interact with them, because only what the players do make a difference. No, no, no. When you are building a campaign that's going to use this technique, you want to build key NPCs. You want to build a little bit of a world wherever it's logical they might explore to. You want to put details. You want to note who these people are, and you want to start them in motion as the players go. So, in other words...
That's true. Yeah, you have to do that. NPCs don't just stand around like in Skyrim, waiting for you to show up at their doorstep so they can fight you. Now, the bad NPCs, the good, even the good NPCs, they're out and about doing stuff. And everything's an encounter. When the players encounter these things, they could encounter the NPC before they start their evil plan. They can encounter the guy when he's in the middle of his evil plan. They can encounter him after a huge battle has occurred, and maybe the bad guy was killed by some army, and you're just picking through the rubble and the burnt ashes, and you find the guy's something something, a note, and you read it, and it might describe what he was up to, what happened there, because you weren't around when the big thing happened.
Words, a mayor may have been a mayor for 10 years, you might write that down, but 6 months into the game.
Also, NPCs need goals. They have motivations, they're character driven, they're going to do what their character would do. They don't care what the players are doing. They might not even know the players are in their neck of the woods.
Campaign, they've been a mayor for 10 years and 6 months, right? And during that 6 months, if any of the word of the player characters had reached the village, or if things were changing, or armies were moving around, or kingdoms have been taken, this would affect that village. How would it affect it? You want to have your notes, and after each play session, you want to sit down and just make quick little notes about how...
Now, if an NPC's motivation is to just stay motionless in one room for eternity, hoping someone opens the door that he's standing next to, if that's the NPC's motivation, guess what? You're playing D&D.
Any of these NPCs or situations might have changed. That way, when the player characters finally do, if they do, get to them, you'll have current information that feels like the world's lived in. So when I say it can be somewhat linear, that doesn't mean that it can be, again, it's not a plot that the DM has set up front. It's not you thinking, hey, in the beginning...
Yeah, plots suck. Don't railroad your characters. Let the players do what their characters would do. Don't let the players paint themselves into a corner. It's like, now what do we do? You always have to have things going on, solutions to everything. Oftentimes the players come up with a way out of a situation that you don't come up with or you didn't plan for. I always have at least 3 ways that players can get out of a situation. Otherwise, it's like, okay, now what? We've run the bottomless pit. Now what? You know, that kind of thing.
At the campaign, they're going to do this adventure so they get this thing, and then that person becomes their enemy. Oh, and then they're going to encounter the big bad early on, and then the big bad's going to teleport out after knocking 3 of them unconscious, and then later on they'll encounter the big bad and they'll do this and that. No. Right, that's exactly what you're not going to do. That stuff might happen, and in fact, whoever the big bad is probably not even decided. In fact, it should definitely not be decided unless it's decided up front, like I said, like as an evil monarch, whatever. Because whoever the players interact with, they might become friends with, they might become foes with, and they might, over time, develop animosity with certain factions, and those become...
Yeah, the NPC could teleport the players away. How about that? Instead of the guy escaping each time. That sucks. I hate that. There's a quest in Skyrim where you're fighting a hag raven and she keeps teleporting further and further into the dungeon. He's like, God damn it. So you're chasing her down and stuff. It's just to lure you into a trap of some kind. But if it's what the character would do, I don't know. I don't know how to get around a situation like that. If teleporting away from the players is what the character would do. It's like, oh, they're gone. Now what? Let's take all of his time travel equipment. Yeah, let's do it.
Become the one of the bad guys of the campaign, if you will. The antagonist to the players. So why do I like this style of play more than, let's say, a more plot-based adventure? For me, I think it's because I think our story is better than my story. My player.
Yeah, that's true. If players are role-playing, the sum of the parts is amazing. This is not, you can't get, as a GM or a DM or a referee or whatever, just making a world or making characters, you can't get that. You can't get the same, what do they call it? The endorphins, is that what they're called? Something in the brain goes, and you're like, oh, power drive. Make sure you have energy drinks on standby because you're going to be in it for 4 hours straight. And you come out at the other end and you're like, holy crap, what just happened? But you're too drained. You're like, I need to like take a break. And everyone's like, for like 45 minutes after a game sessions, everyone's like, wow, everyone's talking about what happened. And you can tell people are just stressed about certain things that were going on because they were like in the moment. You know, someone died. Usually a character dies some horrific way. It's like, holy crap. So then they're like, but they're too drained to think about what, they don't immediately start making new character. No, they're like, I'm gonna have to think this through. Like, you know, cause you're not attached to a character. You're not like emotion, what do they call it? You're not, obsessed with the character. I don't know what it's called. The character's fine, but the situations, the scenes, all that kind of stuff, it was just stuff you were able to accomplish in so short a time because it's real time. And in my games it's real time. There's no, like this guy here, he'll spend 2 hours crossing 5 or 6 hexes just to find a farm. He's got this whole entire map built out. And in one game session, they went from the riverbed to a farmhouse. And then they spend another hour in this empty farmhouse just mucking around looking for, it's an abandoned farmhouse. They spend way too much time in the place. And the players just phone in their role play. They don't have their cameras turned on. They're just using microphones. And they only speak when spoken to. Like they only talk when the game master asks, what are you doing? What do you do? That's the only time they'll talk. So they're just phoning in their thing. They're in no rush to role play. I don't get obsessed with characters so much. I get really involved in the situation, the moment, what was happening. Because oftentimes that scene can happen with another character. I have, you know, because I'm the referee. I got NPCs. I got, you know, bing. You know, there's another NPC I can just use right there. And sometimes, I mean, I do miss some characters when they leave the ship, they go elsewhere because they're not going with the players. So I like that NPC a lot, and maybe, you know, things happen. They didn't connect very well with the players. The players didn't need them. The NPC didn't agree with the players. You know, something didn't connect right. So I got this really neat NPC I wanted to roleplay. but it's just not going to work. And I'm not going to fudge. I'm not going to force my NPCs on the players. Yes, I will come with you. I will stow away on your ship when you're not looking. You know, that kind of thing. I don't do that kind of stuff. I'll just make a new character. But yeah, if a character dies and then after the game session, we're not going to make new characters, no. We're going to soak it in, enjoy the moment, take a few days off, and then, like, my games are typically are on a Sunday night, my time. And I want to say by Wednesday or Thursday, we're talking about what new characters to make for the next Sunday. If there is a next Sunday, it depends. I don't play every week, maybe twice a month. Anyway, what are we doing here now?
Players are really creative. I love to hear what they pull into the world. What they do is usually off book. If you look at things like modules and you're trying to run a module the way it is, they're always doing.
Yeah, I don't do modules. You're in room 15. It's 12 by 7. You see a window on the opposite end of the room, and there's a ghost in the middle of the room coming at you. What do you do?
Doing stuff outside the norm, and that's awesome. So almost always when I start a module, a third the way through it, it's out the window. I mean, I use the baseline of it, but they almost never follow any kind of a thing the module would do. And I love that. I love to have them be involved in creating the world. And
oh, by the way, this guy's a writer, I guess. Songwriter, too. He writes modules for D&D and then play tests them with his entourage of players. Or they beta test it, or they trial run it, or something. I don't know. Maybe he puts the stuff on drive-thru. I have no idea what he does after he writes the modules.
In creating what happens, not some person who wrote a module that I've never met before, but I kind of like their artwork and the theme was good. Also, this type of campaign, you will be surprised as the referee, DM, GM, judge, whatever game you're playing, because you're not going to know where things are going to go. You can really only plan, if you will, out a little bit in advance, because the players are here, they're deciding to do something. You've got.
If I know the players are just going to be on one city street, maybe a city block or something, I'll plan in. The things I'm planning for are maybe two blocks down this way and two blocks down this way. I'm not planning what's going on the other side of the world, because they're not going to be there in that game session. So I'm looking at the scope, and it's basically it's a little bubble. Players are in this bubble. And when the bubble reaches a section they haven't been to yet, I start madly putting stuff there. Boop, 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 boop. Sometimes I let the players put stuff in there. And we just add to it. We just add to the world.
Better kind of be reacting to it. Again, you're going to have your overall idea of what the main NPCs are doing in the world, but you don't need to get into the nitty-gritty of it until the player characters get close to them. And this type of play is really great for all kinds of storytelling. It could be big epic quests.
See, when he says storytelling like that, out of context, I'm thinking he's telling a story to his players, which is heresy. Gotta be careful when you say storytelling like that, and someone like me comes and just pops in at the 4:45 mark and hears you say storytelling to your players, then they're gonna click out if they're not into storytelling games. But you're not talking about storytelling games, are you?
Save the world. It could be political, it could be small relationships, it could be saving the village. All of this and more, and can be done in an emergent storyline way. Because it's really, again, what the characters want to do. If they ignore the village when they ask for help from the raiders, that will come back to them someday, probably. If they help them, that will also come back to them someday, right? It could be as making an enemy, or it could be as boons they might get later on from being heroes. The funny thing about this is you're probably already doing this. Even if you run modules, even if you consider yourself to be running things much more linear.
That's true. You know, a lot of players do this already. Most of them don't go on YouTube and watch other people's videos. So they're not thinking about the vocabulary used here to describe what we're doing, or the nomenclature. Players don't think about that stuff. You know, they'll tell you in polite society that they're a dungeon master and they run D&D games for their friends or at a game store or something. That's as detailed as they get in their hobby description.
If you allow the player characters to do things and you don't do the quantum ogre thing, which, well, side note, we'll talk about quantum.
See, the quantum ogre, I didn't know. I knew that was a thing. I didn't know what it was called until maybe, 12 years ago? When I was watching YouTube, and that's when I heard the term quantum ogre. And there's the Schroeder's cat thing or something. I think that's what it's called. And to this day, I don't think I ever did that. Like, oh, they're avoiding my castle. I'm going to move the castle in front of them until they don't avoid my castle. Skull Castle will be discovered. And they will all die in my castle. Or they'll all be taken prisoner to my dungeon that I made for them. And they just need to... One day I'm just going to have the players wake up from their sleep and they'll be in my castle. Because I'm just going to fucking teleport them into the dungeon. Now they're in my castle. Aha!
Quantum ogre, just in case people don't know what that means. So this idea of quantum ogre is the idea that, like, you've developed an awesome set piece combat with an ogre. So you have a split off in the tunnels, right? And if the players go left, they're going to encounter this ogre, this awesome fight with the ogre. If they go right, they encounter the awesome fight with the ogre, because that's what you set up for tonight. That's the quantum ogre. It's wherever you put it in front of the player characters, because you...
Now, I may have done that. I may have set up something. But that was in the Car Wars days, right? 1981? Yeah, I didn't like Traveler's Vehicle rules, because there weren't really any back then. But Car Wars had vehicle rules. So guess what? And then Champions comes along. Was it Champions 2nd Edition? Guess what happens? And then I still have my copy of Morrow Project. Guess what happens? You know, if a game didn't have rules for a certain thing, we just bolted on another game system to the game. Like, here we go. Let's do this. Using Call of Cthulhu rules, which is the stupidest thing ever. Why would they use Call of Cthulhu rules for the Morrow Project? I never understood that. Anyway. Where was I? Oh yeah, so back in the Car Wars days, I got the road. We got the road sections, you know, we facsimiled all these road sections. We're going to make a road, we're going to race down these roads, and you're going to go to the place I need you to go to. But oftentimes the cars would just get destroyed before they would reach their destination. Oh, and then they get killed too. But, you know, when you're 17, 18, you're thinking, oh, this is going to be so cool. I'm going to have the players do this, and they're going to go through here, and it's going to be like Road Warrior. It's going to be so awesome. Escape from New York. Can't wait. But then it never works out. It's like, so I learned pretty early in life to not even bother making maps. The places we will go, I gave up on that. I learned early on not to write up anything. But I didn't know, back then I didn't know what the alternative was. I didn't know what a sandbox was yet. I wouldn't know what a sandbox would be until what, 1994, which is embarrassing, but I wasn't playing role-playing games. From 84 to 94, I wasn't playing role-playing games. So when I came back to the hobby, GURPS was more mature by then. 96, 97, 98 era, GURPS had all kinds of ways to role-play its game system. All kinds of ways. Anyway.
Decided they were going to fight that ogre. If you don't play like that, if you don't design your adventures like that, you're probably already having an emergent story with your group. And you can be as loose with it and let them just go wherever they like, or, you know, a little bit more constrained, saying, hey, we're running this module.
Now, what I do is if players go into a castle or a ruin or a dungeon, you know, any dungeon, indoor dungeon, underground dungeon, you know, whatever. I immediately get the main hallways in my head, and I might draw something down, you know, write something down on a piece of scratch paper real quick, the gist of the idea. And then if they go through those sections, then yeah, it's going to be hard coded in the game, you know, later on after the session. If my brain isn't fried from role playing, I might fire up, not PowerPoint, what's the thing I use? Anyway, I would just draw a map on that, so I'd have a reference for the next game session. Where they're at. Where did you guys last leave off? And also, I plug in the important things, and they stay there. They don't move around. I mean, if there is something moving around, it's just moving around. I'm role-playing that NPC creature, so it's going to be moving around. It's not going to be hopping around in front of things, behind doors. Aha, you know, no jump scare type stuff. You know, they'll hear a noise. The players can either run away from that direction or head towards the direction. Depends on what their character would do. So they... I try not to be the unreliable narrator. That's my favorite thing, is not me, but I love unreliable narrators. I love that. I don't do that though. I don't on purpose do that. If it happens, that's cool. And I also like that the players will go through a dungeon and they won't see all of it. I like that they miss out on some of the cool stuff that was in the dungeon, because they just didn't go down that way. They found another way out of the dungeon or whatever. They did what they wanted to do and then they left. They didn't stay there all freaking day, you know, just checking everything. They're like, all of a sudden something happens, because it's a sandbox, something more important is going on. They're like, you know, Chewie, get us out of here kind of a thing. And they leave, which is fine. But I'll still write down some stuff. This is the weird part. I'll write down some of the things that I had on the map that they never encountered. Maybe. This might be the quantum ogre thing. Maybe. They'll encounter those things at another dungeon. Maybe. But I doubt it. I mean, in my games, the environments are not the same. No two environments. I'm doing one shots. So the chances of them coming across an identical type of swamp with those kinds of creatures, it might not happen. They're going to be in another environment, so I have to come up with a whole other, you know, shindig that's going on at that location with other creatures and things. But I just like that not everything can be solved or is solved, and the players are like, they're thinking about, you know, when we do our recap or whatever we talk about, you know, they'll ask me, and I'll give spoilers sometimes if they ask. They'll say, what if we had gone down that thing, what would have happened? And I tell them, you know, stuff like that. And they're like, oh, dang, you know, stuff like that. Anyway.
And, you know, please don't leave Barovia. You don't have to force them to stay there with some magical mist or whatever. You know, your players are people that you can interact with, right? So I don't feel like you ever need to force a Quantum Ogre situation on people. I've found very rare times where players have just completely bailed on the adventure. So I wouldn't be too afraid of that.
I'm watching this video because he brings up the Quantum Ogre, which I didn't think would be a topic in this video.
If you are. So there's a couple of little tips here I just want to throw in. One is that when you want to run this style of play, don't be so fixed to a single solution, right? And maybe I'll make a whole video about that. But the idea that, like, you define a challenge, right? The party needs to move these villagers from this place because there's a flood coming to this place. How they do it? However they want to.
Yeah, I don't do that puzzle thing where you got one boat, you got two guys and a donkey, and the boat only fits one person. How do you get everyone across? I don't do that. I don't do that crap. No, the players, I let the players in character decide how they're going to do things. And I think it's fun watching an NPC of mine try first, and they see what happens to him. And then they're like, oh. And then they're like rethinking their plan, you know.
You need to be open to allowing them to do it in a way that's logical. The other thing I would say is let the dice fall where they may. The second that you start fudging dice or changing hit points on monsters in the middle of a combat or any of that kind of stuff, you are no...
But yeah, when players are trying to solve a problem, like I said before, I usually have three ways out of any situation. So they're not going to get trapped. They're not going to run out of ideas. I don't do the thing where that lame ass writer, what was his name? Tolkien. I hate, if he were alive today, he would tell me to start off or something. I hate that he had eagles show up at the end and save the day. I would be that guy who would run into him at a pub and say, and ask, if there were eagles in your setting, why didn't you have the eagles just take them with the ring to the place at the beginning of the book? And then he could say, sawed off.
No longer allowing the table to make the story. You have now taken the reins back, and you are now, it's your story. It's not their story. If the players defeat the dragon in three rounds, they defeat the dragon in three rounds. It doesn't matter if you spent all week making that encounter.
Yeah, players are going to break your stuff, which is fine. Maybe I didn't plan on that to happen. It happened. It's happened. That's the past. We're in the now. So I have to worry about what they're going to do next. I can't be like, oh. And then I'm like, just a downer for the rest of the game session. You killed Horatio, my pet. You know, my pet gargoyle, robotic gargoyle, psionic robotic gargoyle from the future. You know, I raised it since it was just a chip.
That's what they did because they were awesome. Don't take that away from them. So there you go. That's emergent storytelling for me. It's my favorite way to play RPGs. Let me know if you guys have any comments or questions below. Do you guys play this way? Have you tried doing an emergent story? Or do you try to stick to a certain path because why? Let me know in the comments below. I'd love to hear from you. If you like...
That was a good video.